So he also, in September, John Wiley is going to be publishing his next book. It's called Think Two Products Ahead. This is the first time he's been with Peak Potentials. How about a big Peak Potentials welcome, Mr. Ben Mack? Come on, guys.
To make your communication go further and be more powerful. That's what we're going to do. Did we get the cool little, I made this little slide that will be up here in a second. I'm not very good with PowerPoint, but, oh, that's the wrong one. It'll come up in a second. My voice was pulsing through that thing. Cool. There we go. I made that. That's me. That's me art directing. Thank you. I'm not teaching art directing. Harv went through a big portion of the opening, but this is, in essence, the presentation here is called Think Two Products Ahead, Tools the Big Ad Agencies Don't Want You to Know and How to Use Them for Bigger Profits. You're interested in tools? Yes or yes?
Yes.
Cool. Notice at the bottom of this, and if you want it, it's the guy who did some of my art direction, and this is how I partially pay for him. So if you have a need for an inexpensive art director, lushproductions.com, you can email Tim. Lushproductions.com. Most welcome. Harv went through a lot of this, so I don't need to beat you over the head with it. Recently, I was a senior vice president, director of brand strategy at Singular. That's what moved me out to Atlanta. The American Marketing Association gave me two awards. Is Deanna Hannanow in the audience? She was going to come by. Hi, Deanna. Deanna's over there. I worked with her on the Michael Jordan cologne, and that was one of the AMA awards. She and two other people launched Gloss.com, as well as the Michael Jordan cologne, so if you have an interest, you can introduce yourself to her later. The Omega Yo-Yo went from 8 million to over 100 million, sustained the 100 million for 2 years. Now it's down to like 40 million. Toys do that. More importantly, though, there's a gentleman, I'm going to have trouble pronouncing his name, and if there's anyone here from the Netherlands, you might be able to help me. Thank you. Joost, I know that much, and then how do you pronounce the last part? Think, exactly. That's exactly how I say it when I'm not on stage. Just like that. See, the thing is, it's like most of the books that I read on branding, they talk about the branding that you see on television, and they're playing a different game. You know, it's like if I was here drinking a Corona, it would say something. First of all, it would say I'm not an active member of Alcoholics Anonymous. But it would also say something different than if I was drinking a Heineken. You know what I mean? Like, drinking a Corona kind of says, I'm chill. You know, I'm cool, I'm relaxed, I'm vacationing. Drinking a Heineken is sort of like, oh, I'm sophisticated. You know, but I call that flag branding, flag advertising. It's where you've got a big enough reputation that simply having your logo has meaning to other people. But we're not, I don't think anyone, maybe Harv accepted, nobody in this room is really playing that game yet. Is there anybody? If there is, I'll change some of what I'm saying, but it's all good. Okay. What we're interested in is not so much that somebody see your logo and they go, oh, I know what that is, and you're in a room full of people and everyone knows what that is, but it's that the people that do have a relationship with you are compelled to share that relationship with other people. Would that help you make more money?
Yes.
Cool. We're going to go on. A small success that I had last year. Anybody here heard of the comedian Bill Hicks? Perfect. You're going to get it. You love him. If you would pass this back to her. 2 years ago, I created a website called whatwouldbillhickssay.com. people submitted, if Bill Hicks were alive today, what Bill Hicks would say. 3 weeks ago, a book came out that was the result of that online website. So here's the book as well. You're most welcome. For less than $500 in advertising, we had over 500,000 unique visitors to that website. Let me repeat that. For less than $500, we had over 500,000 unique visitors to that website. A big part of how I did it is, did you notice when I brought up Bill Hicks, a few people went, oh yeah, like there was energy within that target audience? So it's when I let people know that there was something going on about Bill Hicks, they were excited and went, and they told friends that went. You know how we got them to tell friends? We asked them. We said, can you help us out? Will you tell friends? One of the other things that I do, it's like, for the most part, I've played a businessman for the last 12 years of my life. And so this is the basic prop that I carry through the airports. And it says, what would Bill Hicks say? Now most people, you know, even as I was coming in here with this, somebody said, who's Bill Hicks? And I was able to tell him a story. I said, he passed away 12 years ago, but it's who David Letterman said is probably the greatest comedian of the 20th century. And he says, can you tell me more? I'd be delighted to. Right now I gotta go meet someone, I can't right now. But I can send you to a book that'll tell you about him. But part of it is, it's like you see a lot of network marketers with buttons that say, ask me about. You know why they do those things? Because they work. The other thing is like how I'm presenting myself right here, right now, I'm a little bit like a businessman. A little bit. Enough to get away in corporate land, I could dress like this. Would anyone be offended if I made fun of when I say corporate land, I mean that place. Yeah, you get it. Would anyone be offended if I made fun of corporate land?
No.
Cool. I'm gonna need everyone's involvement. Put your stuff down, if you will. Excellent. I want everyone to raise your right hand. Gotta get everyone to raise your right hand. We're close, we're almost 100%. Beautiful. At the count of three, I want you to turn around and shake hands with the person behind you. One, two, three. That's my impression of corporate land. Thank you. I paid my way through UCLA as a magician. I was a really good marketer before I knew what it was to be a marketer. And let me put something in context for you. My grandfather, my dad's stepfather, was fired for being a communist. He wasn't a communist. He was simply a union leader, a teacher that said, I don't think we should have to take the loyalty oath. And then he got labeled as a communist and couldn't get much work otherwise. So about 8 years ago, my dad was wound up, you know, crying to me and saying, Benjamin, I can't believe I raised a marketer. True story. And I had to explain to my father, Dad, I think that you and I have a lot of the same values. However, I need to find out how these mechanisms work. You know, because money ain't going away, marketing is not going away. Marketing in and of itself is not evil. It's a tool like TNT. You know, it's a powerful force. It can be used for however you intend to use it. I'd like to ask you guys a favor, that the tools I'm going to teach you, you intend to use for good, okay? Turn to the person next to you, I intend to use this for good. I appreciate that. That makes me feel better. These are just tools, what I'm going to teach you. One of the most valuable things that I did in terms of selling myself as a magician was to ask questions of the people there. Your name is Michael, I can see it. Michael, what do you do for a living? Printing and advertising. When you're taking an order for a print job, do you ever use, is that a paper mate pen that you're using? Yeah? No, the pen, yeah. Perfect, thanks. It's a quill. Michael, are you familiar with the quill pen? It's a chance for you to look at it. What I would wind up doing in magic is then saying to the doing a magic trick where the name appears on both sides of the pen. The trick is kind of irrelevant. The big part was that I was finding out what he did for a living. So then as I went on, I could incorporate him into the magic trick that I was doing. I was also listening for opportunities for me to sell a bigger magic show to him. I paid my way through UCLA working in restaurants and bars 5 to 7 days a week, working 3 or 4 hour shifts. Most of my friends that were magicians were doing it primarily for the tips they were getting that night, bragging about getting $200 nights in tips. I and my friend Steve Barnes were bragging about getting $1,000 shows. Are you going to a trick with it? I used to be a pain with teachers. I'd sit in the back of the class and do this. This is the one that would get me kicked out of class. Who's a big Buckminster Fuller fan? First hand. I go for the first hand, Daniel. Here's the book, Fuller's Earth, A Day with Bucky and the Kids. It's about me and two other kids interviewing Buckminster Fuller from when we were 12. There are a lot of ideas that have stuck with me, and I'm going to incorporate a quote from Buckminster Fuller that in my mind better encapsulates what a brand is than I had seen any place else by any other marketer, and we'll get to that in a little bit. The next part, though, is, you guys are probably wondering why I'm here and I'm not still back in corporate land. In essence, I got myself kicked out. Thank you. It feels good now. I wrote a book, it's called Poker Without Cards. And I explained, what is the primary function of a newspaper? Sell ads. A newspaper is an advertising delivery mechanism. That's its primary function. The primary function of any commercial medium is for it to make money. Branding has gotten a bad name. How many people have ever heard the word brand used in a disparaging light? And for good reason. There's a ton of salespeople out there that are selling in the names of brands. I used to do it. You know, worked in consumer research. The vast majority of consumer research is not about creating truth, it's about supporting somebody's agenda or making money for the research company. Anyway, so in this novel, I tend to write about the wackiness of advertising and how media really works. Who wants a head trip? That one right there? There you go. Here are some quotes I got about the book. As a result of this book, Ben will never work in advertising again. Notice it says advertising, not marketing. I'm a marketer. I want you guys to say it. Say, I'm a marketer. That's a key thing. You are all marketers. What Harv did this morning is something that's critical. I've never seen anyone else did it. When I work with clients, I often have them take a pen. Hold up your pen. This is a magic wand. Repeat after me. This is a magic wand. I can do whatever I want with this. Now turn to yourself and say, I'm a marketer. Perfect. Perfect. So Douglas Rushkoff said, as a result of that book, Poker Without Cards, Ben will never work in advertising again. If you read it, neither will you. May this clever virus infect the media space before it's too late. The reason why I put virus there is, and I'm going to bring this simple and down to tools you can use in just a moment, but I need to get over the complicated stuff first. I used to be called a memeticist. A memeticist. A person who studies memes and memetics. A meme is a single unit of thought. And the neat thing is, if you look at thoughts as a living organism, you can actually apply all the laws of biology to thoughts. Isolation breeds mutation. You've heard that in biology. That's how foreign languages begin. I can go down the list and they'll all play out. I've never had a biologist say, here's one that doesn't work. The neat part is about memetics is that it also incorporates some of the notions of entrainment, of physics. There's a term entrainment in physics. Have you ever been out camping and you've had two generators across a field, and when you first start them off, you hear that they're at like a slightly different rhythm? and then they go for a while and they come to a common rhythm. That's called entrainment. There's less energy that's required to go in the common rhythm than it is to keep one's own course. That's why when you leave here, it's so important to keep in contact with people that have picked up these ideas, because you're not going to get them reinforced by other people. And generally speaking, you're not going to get these kinds of ideas reinforced. So entrainment, let's look at the Southern accent. This gets me in trouble all the time. From a music perspective, the tempo of the Southern accent is an amalgamation of a lot of tempos that you'll find in Africa, and to a lesser extent, those that you'll find in Europe. If you listen to the Southern accent, if you have a musicologist, listen to the tempo of a Southern accent, the rhythm of it, the tempo, and certain other parts of the sound, I don't know music well enough to articulate it, is an amalgamation of the rhythms and nuances of Africa and of Europe. Because it was easier to entrain to get into a common rhythm. And that's a way that physics is showing up in mimetics, you know, of how physics can affect thoughts in a way in which was not thought probable before. Back to the quotes, there's two more here I'm proud of, and thank you for your indulgence, but this was fun. Robert Anton Wilson is one of my heroes. He's sick right now, but he's still there. This was flattering. If Ben Mack wrote a consciousness thriller combining natural philosophy with storytelling, the effect is like taking acid, only you never come to... I would not know. It's just what he said. Richard Brody wrote, "Poker Without Cards reveals the hard to swallow truth that one cannot truly know reality until one understands mimetics and poker. Is the world ready for such a revolution?" He wrote a book called Virus of the Mind, and notice also there it says Microsoft Word. He wrote Microsoft Word. Onwards and upwards. So this is called Think Two Products Ahead. Anyone want to take a guess why this is called Think Two Products Ahead? It's about marketing. You want to think two products ahead. You get a prize. I find, and I hear advertising creative sense all the time, there's no crime in clarity. Write that down, please. There's no crime in clarity. It's called Think Two Products Ahead because I want you to think two products ahead. Back to what I was saying about getting the $1,000 magic show, I wasn't thinking about the $5 tip at the side of the table. I was thinking about the $1,000 magic show. Think two products ahead could also be thought of think two sales ahead. You're not just thinking about making your current sale. Say that. I'm not just thinking about making my current sale. One more time. I'm not just thinking about making my current sale. Thank you. It's similar to where I got this phrase from was in pool. I talked to some billiards teachers, and they said that the students made the breakthrough when they started thinking two shots ahead. That they're seeing the pool table differently when they start thinking two shots ahead. And so that's where I came up with the idea of think two products ahead. You need to be thinking two sales ahead. It's about the back-end profits. It's not about your first sale. With your first sale, you're developing trust. With your second sale, you're developing more trust. Then they're willing to trust you a lot more. You also need to be proving yourselves as you do these things. This isn't a hustle. You know, it needs to be authentic. Harv had talked about, and I was grateful for his introduction, that I was going to be teaching you guys about templates. And I'd love to give a demonstration. If I may give a demonstration from back when I was doing magic, but I think it's related. Cool. I'd like to share with you this quote first. It's, "Any sufficiently advanced technique is indistinguishable from magic." That's what a template is. If someone's using a template and not sharing with you that it's a template, many times you go, "Wow, how did you come to that so quickly?" It's because they've already thought it through. Or they had someone else that thought it through. So what I'm going to show you now is theater, okay? What I'm about to show you is from Imagine Me When I'm 15 and I'm on stage. And so I used to do a Powers of the Mind routine with ESP and card tricks and stuff along those lines. And I'd explain that this is a magic square. In fact, I'll do it right now. This is a magic square. There's nothing actually magical about this. What I'm going to do is, for instance, sir, will you help me with this? You can stay where you are. You're agreeing to help. Thank you. Jordy, we haven't met. We didn't prearrange anything, correct? I want you to think of a number between 20 and 100. You have that in your mind? Okay, cool. In a moment, I'm going to use that number. For now, I'm going to explain to you what I'm going to do. You're familiar with how the left and the right side of the brain can work together? And if the right side, the creative side, is stimulated, it allows the left side, the analytic side, to work more efficiently? What we're going to do in a moment is Jordy is going to give me a number between 20 and 100. I'm going to try and fill a number so that in any given direction, it's going to equal the number that you're presently thinking of. Tony is going to help me in the back. Tony's going to play some music that will stimulate my mind as we go. So, Jordy, what number would you like me to use? You had to pick a big one. I can do it. It's going to be tougher for them to follow. It'll be a better demonstration. I can do 98. You can say yes. It'll be an easier demonstration for them if you pick a number in the 30s or 40s. 98 or a number in the 30s or 40s? Which one? 98? Very good. I'll try and make it easier for you guys. Hold on. If you have a pocket calculator, you can take it out and add along with me as we go. Across the top row here, 78 and 1 is 79, plus 12 is 91, and 7 is 98. Jordy, you chose 98. Try this. 11 and 8 is 19, plus 77 is 96, and 2 is 98. 5 and 10 is 15, 3 is 18, 80 is 98, 9 and 6 is 15, 79 is 94, and 4 is 98. Try up and down. 4 and 5 is 9, 11 is 20, 78 is 98, 79 and 10 is 89, 8 is 97, 1 is 98, 6 and 3 is 9, 77 is 86, 12 is 98, 9 and 80 is 89, 2 is 91, and 7 is 98. Turn diagonal, 7, 77 is 84, 10 is 94, 4 is 98, 78, 8 is 86, 3 is 88, 89, 9 is 98. Turn the center set of 4, 3 and 10 is 13, 8 is 21, 77 is 98, corner block, 9 is 6 is 15, 3 is 18, 80 is 98, 2 and 77 is 79, 12 is 91, 7 is 98, 1 and 8 is 9, 11 is 20. 78 is 98, these also, try these two, 1 and 12 is 13, 6, 19, 79, 78, these two, 82 is 82, 5 is 87, 11 is 98, bottom of the floor, 6 is 79, 85, 10 is 93, 3 is 98, these also, try these two, 72 is 9, 11 is 20, 78 is 98, these two work. My favorite are the cross diagonals. 5 is 79 is 84, 2 is 86, 12 is 98, 1 and 11 is 12, 6 is 18, 8 is 98, even out for quarters, 4 and 9 is 13, 7 is 20, 78 is 98. You guys ready to learn some templates about big business? I've worked at 7 different ad agencies. And at the 7 different ad agencies, I've seen 7 different proprietary marketing schemes. Now, I want to translate for you guys. When you hear the word proprietary, that means my template. Just in case anyone's curious. I helped create some of these. Blair Warren. BlairWarren.com. Blair Warren is an interesting guy. He's a little bit of a recluse. He's definitely an introvert. He's a persuasion guy. He and my buddy Dave, Dave's in the back row here, are experts in persuasion, and either one of them, Dave in particular, have read far more than I ever will have read. Blair Warren has a one-sentence persuasion thing where in 26 words he says, I can teach you the core of virtually every persuasion thing that's out there. It's not entirely true. But he says, before I teach the 26 words, I want the people to understand that when you read these 26 words, you're going to be disappointed. And so he spends 12 pages explaining about the last time he bought a magic trick. Who in here has ever bought a magic trick? And when you opened up and you got home and you read how it worked, you were disappointed, yeah? And it's hard to remember back to where it was where you said, that was amazing. So what I'm about to show you is going to be underwhelming. So before I do that, we've got some handouts that are going to come down here. And let's give them a round of applause for helping out. I took off and I told them I was going to do it. Thank you. On the front page of this, you can see the formula for how I did the magic square. Oh, you'll get the rest is coming down from the other side. X equals the number minus 98. You can see that, so that's 78. You got that? Okay. You'll see it in a second.
It's coming. It's coming down.
Harv said that there were two things that you have to know, remember? What was number one? One more time? And the second part was? That second part of why they should buy from me, I want you to turn to the second page of this. Here is your goal, where it says magic is simply irresistible. This first part here, this diagram here, explains what you're going to talk about in any communication. The consumer has their whole life, right? And hopefully our business intersects with their life, right? You only want to talk about the stuff that overlaps, okay? That's tough. I only want to talk about the stuff that overlaps. Say it loud. Because if you don't, you'll lose them. What I'm going to teach you guys is to help you make more money. That's me anchoring your interest. That's me making sure I'm jumping back into your world. Okay? As you're communicating with your prospects, you want to be jumping into their world and only talking about yourself to the extent that it's relevant to them. So you want to talk about the stuff that overlaps, but what stuff do you talk about? Talk about what's in it for them. I talk about what's in it for them. Preferably an emotional benefit. Cool. On the next page, turn to the third page of this. I'm going to have you guys do an exercise. After the exercise, I'm going to teach you the template of branding. On this page, I'm going to read it out loud. This is an exercise. Write an exhaustive list, it doesn't need to be too exhaustive, of why people give you money, their reason for buying. If you presently don't have a business up and running, use this seminar as your example. Use World Greatest Marketing if you don't know what your business is. The importance here is the exercise. It's not the results that you come to right now. Does that make sense? I'm giving you the tool that you can do later on. We don't necessarily need to come to the solution right now. I want to explain to you some of the stuff of that could be down there. When I sent these to Kinko's, apostrophe S's and colons sometimes look funny. So there's where it says, let's say, that's what an apostrophe looks like going from a Macintosh to their PC system. So I'm sorry. Let's say that you sell automobile insurance. Why people buy it? A, in many states, they're legally required, right? It could be to protect the car. It could also be to protect the house. Like, if you own a house and you get into a car accident and you don't have enough automobile insurance, they can take your house. So now, when we think about why people buy auto insurance, let's look across the part legally required. Well, when I buy it, I now have peace of mind. Because I'm not nervous about, like, if a cop pulls me over, that I've got proof of insurance, right? Another part is, you know, somehow the EI thing is looking at apostrophe begins thing on. Easily makes it, another emotional benefit is that it's easy for me to buy. You know, like this one particular place, yeah, I bought auto insurance because it was easy to buy from them. You know, that actually can be an emotional benefit. It's like someone knows, I'm required to buy it, so I'm going to go over here where it's easy to buy. You know, but for the second one, to protect a car, emotional benefit. Can you see how confidence is an emotional benefit of buying auto insurance? Another, well-rested. You know, you don't have to worry. You're able to get sleep because it's one less thing on your mind. Protect your house. Being responsible. In many ways, buying enough insurance is an expression of love for your family. If you doubt this, talk to somebody who's lost their house or estate because they didn't have enough insurance. And talk to them about the impact that had on their family. It's real easy, real fast, to be able to see the legitimacy of buying auto insurance as an expression of love for your family. Another example, let's say about, you know, buying a cell phone. You need it for work. I feel more productive when I have a cell phone. It can also be about empowerment. In case of emergency, confidence, I'm able to feel calm, I feel connected wherever I go. What I want you to do is, let's have it be your turn. I want you to write down why your customers buy from you. So in that first column, you're going to write a rational benefit, just like in the three columns above, a tangible reason why people might buy from you. In the middle column, you're going to write down an emotional benefit. And in the right column, you're going to write down a different emotional benefit. I'm going to give you guys 3 minutes to work on this. How long? Work fast. Thank you. I'm going to want you to participate out loud, so I'm going to need for everybody to quiet back down so we can hear what people want to share. Who was surprised by what they uncovered? Was anybody surprised? Sir, if we could have a mic, stand up if you will, and someone will bring you a microphone.
My name is Blaise. I'm from Ottawa, Canada. And I'm a natural anti-aging. I help women look 5-15 years younger. And what I discovered is that the main benefit for them is that they feel more powerful and in control by feeling more attractive.
Very neat. Very cool. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you. I think that Deanna could relate, because if I may share this, when Gloss first came up, the essence that you came up with for Gloss was the sense of shine. And it was that you had this inner power that would radiate through. And so what you came up with there was very similar to what Deanna's company had come up with in terms of how women feel powerful when they feel better about their external and better inside. Thank you. Who else was surprised with something that they found? If you'd stand, and we'll have a microphone to you in a second. If I could see someone else, we could get a microphone. Great, that one right there. If you'll stand, we'll get a microphone over to you. Thank you.
I do sales for a party planner who does a lot of private parties for very high-end clients up in the Bay Area and San Francisco, and for corporate clients. And I never really thought about this for the corporate clients, but obviously for the private clients, everyone likes to throw a great party, and the emotional benefit is if they feel good and they have no hassle with their plans, then of course, you know, it makes others feel good and they can enjoy their party. But what I got for the corporate one that is if we put together a kick-ass presentation for them, that not only will they look good, but their CEO will look good, which will give them confidence in their job.
Neat. There's job security by going with a company that's going to deliver well. Very cool. Let's give a round of applause. Thank you. We'll take one more so we can get a microphone to that gentleman in the second row. We'll get there next. Yes.
My name is Sarah. I'm from Philadelphia. And I had a dance school. And we have adults that we teach partner dancing, ballroom dancing to. And we also have children that we teach break dancing and all that kind of stuff. And I just now realized how, even though the product is different and the way we present it is different for the two different schools, the exact same emotional benefits are coming across. That the kids, when they actually get this step, are feeling confident, are feeling that they can master some skill that they had not previously had. And the same thing applies to adults, is that, yeah, we go out in situations where we have to dance, and now men can feel like they can take their wife out on the floor. The women feel like when you leave them, they know what to do. So that it was a lot more about the emotional benefit of feeling good and confident than it is about the dance at all.
Yes. The dance becomes a delivery mechanism for confidence. Very cool. I don't eat tortilla chips. I don't. Tortilla chips, no. I eat a guacamole delivery mechanism.
Hi, I'm Carl Arena from Northern California. Actually, what I noticed here with this exercise was, well, first, I'm trying to shift my business from being a private practitioner into being a high voltage healer. Mm-hmm. And so what I've been grappling with is being paid by the hour. And so what I saw here is that, first of all, people buy from me because I'm really good at what I do. Mm-hmm. And they experience the work and they come back because they don't get it anywhere else. They also know that the tools that I use, they are effective. So it builds confidence in them. So the running emotional benefits I kept coming up with was comfortable, feeling better, getting in touch with their bodies, feeling confident that I knew what to do and how to do it. They feel heard.
They feel heard.
Like I am actually listening to what is going on in their body, okay. And therefore I can address it. That builds some loyalty. And ultimately, they're willing to risk their vulnerability so that I can actually give them the coaching that's necessary and show them a viable program so that they can become empowered by their own healing process.
So their ultimate benefit is empowerment through healing?
In essence, yes.
Cool. Thank you. Let's give a round of applause. I'm going to allow a few questions in a moment, but right now I want to show you guys how we're going to use this, okay? Here's how every branding system I've ever seen works. You synthesize a lot of data. What do you synthesize? I don't know. Who your competition is, what your emotional benefits are, how you're differentiated, a whole lot of stuff. You extract a brand essence. You synthesize, you extract, and you amplify. That's it. That's branding. Turn the page on your book. You can see it in the handout. This, in essence, is every branding scheme I've ever seen. Basically, it gets a lot more complicated than this, but you synthesize a lot of stuff, you extract the brand essence, and then you amplify the brand essence. The reason why I had you guys do that emotional exercise first is I want to put up, there's a quote that we have. Tony, if we could put up the quote on the big screen. This is from Dale Carnegie. And he says that when dealing with people, and how many of you have a target audience that's people? And how many people, how many of you here own a dog or have ever seen one? And how many of you just don't like raising your hands? I'm trying to get you to raise your hand. Thank you. All right, we got a thumbs up. That worked. All right. When dealing with people, remember you're not dealing with creatures of logic, but with creatures of emotion. Creatures bristling with prejudice and motivated by pride and vanity. What I'm going to suggest is that whatever is your ultimate emotional benefit that you came up with on that other page, that's your brand essence. Let me repeat that. Whatever is your optimum emotional benefit that you can give your patrons, your customers, your prospects, that is your brand essence. Turn the page of the handout, if you will. Your brand essence is your common thread. What do I mean by common thread? Have you ever looked at something and said, oh, that's the common thread that runs between those things? That's what your common thread is. Your common thread is your brand essence. Every communication that you have with your customers should be reinforcing your brand essence. Every touch that you have with your customers should be reinforcing whatever that emotional benefit is. A friend of mine sells some energy tablets for bicyclists, and he sells them through direct response, through ads and bicycling magazines, and he sent it to me, and he said, Ben, what can I do to enhance my brand? And he's very into recycling and ecologically minded stuff. And so he uses recycled newspapers to crumple up inside the box. And so it's all recycled goods, the packaging, and all that kind of stuff. And I said, that's great. It is awesome. I said, what I want you to do is go to the local bicycling store. And when the bicycling magazines at the end of the month, they rip off the front page and they send the front page back to the publisher. I said, get the rest of those magazines. Take the pages of those magazines, put them in that box. Guess what happened? His retention, because it's a monthly supplement, his retention doubled. Why do you think his retention doubled? Because of the magazine page. Because he's better reflecting the passions of his buyers. He's reflecting their emotions. Look, we live in a screwed up world where a lot of times people, you know that phrase of quiet desperation? Guess what? The vast majority of people out there are living lives of quiet desperation. You guys are awake enough to get your asses here, excuse my language, but to be here and trying to be proactive.
Yeah.
Give yourselves a round of applause on that. The vast majority of people do not see their ideas and their values and their passions reflected often enough, or sometimes at all. This phrase up there with Dale Carnegie, you know, about emotions are going to be the strongest leverage, the strongest motivators. So anytime you've got a communication, you want to know what to write about? Write about that emotional benefit that you just uncovered. It doesn't mean to necessarily make that emotional benefit, you know, that you say in every third word. In fact, that would not work. But before you let a communication go out, ask yourself this question on the bottom. Does this communication reinforce a sense of my brand essence? Anybody know what my brand essence is? Magic. I wrote it down there. Yes. You get a choice between Seth Godin's All Marketers and Liars or a limited edition IntelliShit sticker. Part of Poker Without Cards, Poker Without Cards, over 300,000 people downloaded Poker Without Cards Again, a marketing budget of less than $1,000. I printed out 3,000 bumper stickers that say, warning, this is IntelliShip. And it's got a profile of a head with some stinking crap in it. And I gave 1,500 of them to a friend that was going to Burning Man, and they passed them out. And on the back, it simply says, pokerwithoutcards.com. You know, read the book that makes people go crazy. Free download of book through Poker Without Cards. Kurt Vonnegut meets Herman Hesse, da-da-da-da-da, blows your mind. 300,000 people downloaded it. Thanks, because this matched the sentiment of a lot of the people at Burning Man. You know, they saw this, they said, wow, cool. I don't see this. Finally, someone's speaking to me. Harv is talking about getting to know your target audience. Get to know them. You know what? Love them. If you're not loving your target audience, find another target audience or find another line of work. I take this marketing stuff seriously because marketing, in my mind, is one of the strongest, most powerful tools on the face of this planet. Marketing is what garners consensus. Part of the reason why I take every opportunity that I can to speak is I want to explain as best as I can how this stuff works. Repetition, absolutely. Repetition. Thank you. Repetition is the number one thing that works. But it's not necessarily repeating the exact same phrase. It's repeating the notion. It's repeating the essence. When you extract your brand essence is that note, is that emotion, is that meme that you want to keep coming back to. Can I talk about biology for a minute? In biology, they say that for an organism to survive, every living organism on Earth that biologists have studied happen to have three things in common with them: fidelity, fecundity, and longevity. Fidelity is that it can accurately reproduce itself. That's why you get a lot of the hogwash that branding is about the color template, about the exact replication of the logo and that kind of stuff. That's not branding. You know what? Logos change, and yet people still buy from that brand, right? But you need to be able to replicate yourself well. What are you replicating? You're replicating a relationship. You're replicating that brand essence. You're extending that relationship that is anchored around the brand essence. Remember how many of you guys have ever seen the movie or the play, The Music Man? The Wells Fargo Wagon movie, coming around the, yeah, that whole thing, I can't sing. Well, Wells Fargo used to be an express service. Well, guess what happened? A war broke out in the United States, and we said, you know what? Those express services, they're all now part of the United States. The government took over all those express services. The vast majority of the express services that were around back then no longer exist. Wells Fargo does, or now I believe it just got gobbled up, but Wells Fargo did. Why? Wells Fargo had a relationship. People trusted them with their valuables. Trust with the valuables was their brand essence. That's what they promised people. They promised people, we're gonna respect your valuables and get them where we agree to get them. They built up that trust. And so when the express deliveries, you know, when that business went away, they still said, oh, we've got this stuff. People trust us. They trust us with their valuables and their money. Let's find a business around that. What you're seeking to do is build a relationship and a reputation around your brand essence. Let me get back on track over here because we don't have that much time. I can misplace the... Okay. Yeah. Fecundity. Oh, thank you. Fecundity is being able to produce more than one of yourself. Longevity is the notion in biology that you give your offspring some sort of advantage, and that's part of why some biologists don't view viruses as alive, because there's no real advantage given to the offspring. I happen to view viruses as alive because, you know, we kill them. That is true. You know, the thing about evolution is that evolution seems to work for a gene pool, not for the individual. So, all right, I'm going to get back to this because I've got 21 minutes left to go, and I've given away one secret, right? I gave away that the branding thing, and I taught you guys how to use it. Okay, cool. I want to make sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
We've already done this. You guys, we've played with circling the emotional benefit. We've gone through this. I went out of order. I'll get back to this in a second. That one sentence, if you can circle it and if you can put that someplace where you'll remember to use it, because there's a lot of times where people go, I don't know if I should send this out. You know, and just ask yourself this one question of, does this blank communication reinforce my, whatever your brand essence is? Now we're going to get into USP. USP stands for? Cool. I've heard that, I've also heard of USP referring to unique selling point. You know, there's a lot of times where the same acronym gets in different things. I'd like to show you guys another magic trick. Would that be okay? All right. Right on! Who was it that said that? Would you stand up? Can we bring her a microphone? While we're bringing her a microphone, can we pass out the perfect? All good. What is your name?
Lisa.
Lisa, may I show you the most amazing card trick you've ever seen in your entire life?
Please.
And if when I'm done, if it is not the most amazing card trick you've ever seen in your entire life, will you be honest with me?
Yes, I'm a member of Magic Castle.
You are a member of the Magic Castle. Then, well, thank you. Lisa, I'm going to get someone else. I appreciate your... Who else wants to play? Right here. This one right here. When I started performing at the castle when I was 14, they actually let me on stage and talk all I want, which was really brave of them. And your name is Shelley. Shelley, when I show you this card trick, you'll be honest with me at the end. If it's not the most amazing, you'll let me know.
I will.
Okay. This is an invisible pack of playing cards. Can you see them?
Nice.
No, they're invisible.
Yes.
It's a regular size pack. I'm just holding them by the side. What I'm going to ask you to do, if you'd step out to the side, because I'm going to need this gentleman to hold the microphone for you while you do something for me. Very good. I'm going to toss you this pack of playing cards. Can you catch them?
I could.
Very good. Excellent. On the invisible table in front of you, I want you to take the cards out of the box and shuffle them up. Very good. Now you're showing off. Spread the cards face down across the table. Push one card forward. Pick it up, look at it. It's not the Queen of Hearts, is it?
Yes.
Place that card back in. The reason why I ask is because many women pick the Queen of Hearts. Spread the cards back down. I want everyone else in the room to think of a number between 1 to 4. You got the number in your mind? How many of you are thinking of 3? Humans are fairly predictable along certain lines. If it was a guy that was standing up, guys that are here, you're thinking of a playing card? I bet a bunch of you are thinking of the Ace of Spades. We're kind of predictable. So you've looked at a different... Hold up the card. Don't put it back down. You got it in your mind. Show it to everyone else. I won't look.
Card?
It's not the Queen of Hearts, right?
Oh.
A different card, yeah.
Oh, you want me to put another card?
Yeah. It's a lot less impressive if we come to the end, it's the Queen of Hearts.
Okay.
You got it?
I got it.
Okay. Show everyone else, I won't look. You got it? Place it face up amongst the face down cards. Shuffle your cards back together. So your card is the one card from the wrong direction of the pack, right?
Okay.
Take all the cards, place them back in the box. Close a little flap. Take the entire pack and throw it at me. Boom, pop. As if that's not amazing enough. You guys are tough. What was the one card you turned the wrong direction in your pack?
Jack of Spades.
The Jack of Spades. Because the only card turned the wrong direction in this pack is this one playing card. Come on up here. I would get calls and people would say, Ben, I need you at my party. Because Shelley told me that you did for her the most amazing card trick she'd ever seen in her entire life. I would get that phrase repeatedly. I need you at my party. Blankety blank said that you showed them the most amazing card trick they'd ever seen in their entire life. Thank you. I gave the framing. That was my unique selling proposition. You guys see that? I asked for the validation beforehand. You know, if I'm about to show, would you like to see the most, may I have permission to show you the most amazing card trick you've ever seen in your entire life? If after I do this, if it's not, will you let me know? Now I've got validation that she's going to engage. Because if she says no, you know what? I'd love an opportunity to show her something else. Because if it had been this woman over here from the Magic Castle, I'm doing a different trick. You know, if it was that woman there at the Magic Castle, Michelle, would you help me with something? As I go through the pack, just memorize one of these cards. Did you memorize one? Yes? You didn't actually make one up, you saw one of these playing cards, yes? The playing card that you were looking at, it was a face card? Yes, no? Yes or no?
What's a face card?
Oh,
I see, no.
It wasn't? I blew it. It's not going to work, and I'm not going to do it twice. I tried to force on her the Queen of Clubs by slightly pausing and stuff along those lines. And it was going to be very subtle, and it was trying to do a trick for this woman back. Forgive me. Let me get back to the marketing lesson. Thank you. My bad. Thanks. I went for the gold, and I came this close. But the unique selling point is hopefully something that is small, that is repeatable. Back to these things of the fidelity, the fecundity, longevity. I've done that trick literally tens of thousands of times. And I've gotten people to replay that line back to me. Why? Partially because I've said it to them four or five times. Partially because I've told them this is how you're supposed to see this thing. If I had more time, I was going to play for you guys a videotape that where there's two teams playing basketball, and I ask you guys to count how many times one of the two teams passes the ball. And then at the end, I ask you guys how many was it, and people would say 16 or 18 or whatever. And I'd say, did anyone see anything unusual? And you guys would go, no. And I'd play the video again, and only the second time through, you'd notice a gorilla going through the video. And it's like, literally, people don't see the gorilla. Why? Because you told them what to look for. You told them to look for the balls passing. Your unique selling point is what you're telling people to look at. To me, the most valuable thing in terms of your interaction with your customers is your instructions. Why? Because they've got your product in your hand at the time when they're holding the instructions, and you're telling them, you're guiding them what to look at. How powerful is that? When I worked at Wong Duty Advertising, Tracy Wong, when we worked on the 50s hamburger chain, Johnny Rockets. When we worked on Johnny Rockets, Tracy Wong did the table tents. Why? Because that's what the customers are going to see when they're eating their meal. Who's most valuable to you? Your current customers. Why? Because you're thinking two products ahead. You can't be making two sales ahead until you've got your customer. A lot of what you're going to hear the rest of the weekend is about how to get that customer. You're going to hear from David Garfinkel, who is a master... Oh, I'm not allowed to say anything. I blew that. I'm sorry, Harv. My bad. Okay. There's a mystery copywriter who's really good. And he's going to help you get a sale. And when you apply his techniques, I want you to keep in mind the idea of the brand essence, okay? Cool. All right, let me go on. Thank you.
Letters for Jack of Spades for an extra hour.
Cool. Overarching grant. So here's the thing. All right, let's talk about peak potentials for a second, okay? Because you guys are familiar with that. Peak potentials probably has some sort of overarching emotional benefit, yeah? Something along the lines of empowerment. But then within that, there are going to be other products or sub-grants. There's going to be other directions that you go that, you know what, within that area, they're going to ladder up to empowerment or what, you know, whatever that emotional benefit would be. So you can have clusters, but overall, if something's not peak potential, it says in the name. It's helping people find their peak potentials, right? So are they going to offer something about floral arrangement? Maybe. If it can help you reach a peak potential of some sort. You know, but everything is either going to be going towards helping you uncover your peak potential, or it's not going to be part of their brand. And any line of products or any sub-products has to figure out how it's going to work itself into that notion. Let me keep going, so I've got 11 minutes left. So a quick review. You know, what is a brand? It's not a name. It's not a logo. It's not a color scheme. These are accessories for your brand. Repeat after me. These are accessories for my brand. I am my brand. People buy from me because they trust me. I don't care as much about this sale as I care about the next. Are there questions before I go on? Otherwise, I'm going to go kind of quick for the next 6 minutes. One question. Microphone, real quick. The previous screen, going back real quick. Yes. Oh, you just wanted to copy it down. All good. No. These will somehow be made available to you guys. I've only got 9 more minutes, and I got to get over to UCLA. I'm going to be late for speaking at the Anderson School of Business, so I'm sorry. Forgive me. I'm already going to be late. A brand is not an exact discipline. A brand is not about always using the same logo or color. It's not about limiting yourself. You know how it's like there are certain things where somebody goes, oh, I'm manic? You know what? A person saying manic and a doctor saying manic are two different things. We are all marketers, okay? So we're going to throw out the dictionary definition of a brand. Dictionary says a trademark or a proper name identifying a product, service, or manufacturer. You know what? Names change, and the companies stay in business, and the brand equity exists. So here's what I'm going to recommend instead. Brand, definition number one. We'll find a way to get you guys these slides. The positive or negative inclination to purchase, either in an individual or among a target audience. So your brand is likelihood for someone to do business with you again. It's about the back end. It's about thinking two products ahead. The aggregation of stories and associations around a trademark, distinctive name, or product line is what we're going to get to next. Two, a verb transitive, to increase the target audience's likelihood to purchase, to brand something, to imbue positive characteristics into a marketed proposition. And finally, three, noun, slang, a colloquial word for a logo, product name, or product line. Dennis Dictionary of My Language, first edition. Thank you. Dr. Mr. Fuller, 1964, in his book Synergy, wrote, pattern integrity is when a pattern has integrity independent of the medium by virtue of which you receive the information that exists. Sounds like a brand to me. If you wind up saying something and they go, oh, that sounds like Ben, that's part of my pattern integrity. You got it? Your brand is this pattern integrity. It's some sort of structure that when your gut goes, oh, you know what, that's part of it. Anytime anyone tells a story about you, it's part of your legend. Man, this time is going fast. I've got 7 minutes to go. What is your brand? Your brand is the cumulative story of your product, companies, and users. Your brand is the origin of your legend. It's the never-changing, non-negotiable essence, the company from which your legend is born. Why am I talking about legends? Because a legend is a form of communication. It's a single legend can have multiple stories. You know, like Paul Bunyan? There are all sorts of stories about Paul Bunyan, and a lot of them are contradictory. and yet it's still Paul Bunyan. Think about TV commercials. Ads, they tell a lot of stories. If you were to think about the characters and the stories, they might contradict each other. You know what? It's building a larger aggregate, right? I'm going to suggest that your brand is your legend. Legends are advantageous because they're larger than life stories that are told and retold. They have a meaningful connection with an audience, and they grow stronger as they age. I hear a lot of people that get shy and they go, I don't like it when people look at me. Or I don't like it when people talk about me. I like it when people talk about me. I like it when people talk about me. I like it when people look at me.
I like it when people look at me.
That's how you're going to make money. Make yourself worthy of looking. Make yourself likable in some ways. Most important thing in my mind is be candid. Next part is your hero biography. Within every legend, there must be a hero, a character whose story is told. Guess what? I want you guys to repeat after me. My product is not my hero. Your customer is the hero of your story. You don't need to repeat this part. Your customer is the hero of your story, and your product or service is what facilitates their heroic activities. Can you see? Can you understand that? Your customer is my customer is my hero.
My customer is my hero.
Cool. In identifying your hero biography, we're locating and defining the core essence of your brand. Got to figure out what the emotional benefit is that you're serving them. You serving them. You're serving them. Brief on, to go this real fast, Cliff Bar. I worked on Cliff Bar. I've worked on a lot. I've been in this business for 12 years. People like stories that reflect their values. When this bicyclist looks at the Cliff Bar, they say, that's me, which is awesome. But here's the thing. If we elevate our users to heroes, we elevate our brand to a legend because we're included in their story. By celebrating our consumers as heroes, we celebrate ourselves. Cliff Bar, as a shorthand, is fuel for the modern-day athletic adventurer, if you will. That was kind of like their unique selling point, if you will, or their shorthand of what it was. Either we reflect people accurately, like the person on the bike saying, I'm an athletic adventurer, or we facilitate them to see a positive image of themselves. I like it when I think of myself as an adventurer. This book that Douglas has now, that all marketers are liars, the subtitle of it, can I have it back for a moment? Thanks. I'll give it right back to you. The power of telling authentic stories in a low-trust world. And he explains all marketers tell stories, and if they do it right, we believe them. We believe that wine tastes better in a $20 glass than a $1 glass. We believe that an 80,000 Porsche Cayenne is vastly superior to a 36,000 VW Touareg, even if it is virtually the same car. We believe that the $225 Pumas will make our feet feel better and look cooler than the $20 no-names. And believing it makes it true. So for goodness sakes, be authentic with them, because that's the only way that they're going to be believing it. And believing it is what makes it true. And wouldn't it be a better world if we had something that we all liked believing in? Keep it real, guys. Thank you. All right, we're on the home stretch because I'm running out of time. So here's an exercise that we can have up on the big screen, the slide. Here's what I'm going to ask you guys to do, and that is to create the circle. You're not going to have time to do it now, but I want you to create three circles within each other. In that center circle is where you're going to write your emotional benefit. You know, your core emotional benefit. In that next outer ring out, you're going to write other benefits that contribute to that ultimate emotional benefit. You know, some benefits, things that ladder up to that larger idea. And in the outer ring, I want you to write any attribute that, and by attribute, any touch that a customer has with you or your brand or your product or in any way in which they would be thinking about your company. This is going to be Professor Xu Zheng. Oh, I'm sorry. Hi, Cher. I'm still on stage. I'm sorry, we got going a little. Can you guys say hi to Cher? I'm off stage in a minute and 48 seconds. I'm heading there. Okay. Yeah, see you soon, Chair. Thank you. Let's look at Marlboro. Some people get thrown by this because of cigarettes. Put that aside for a second. Marlboro is an extraordinarily well-known brand, and it's easy for me to teach from this one. I don't promote nicotine. I also don't promote cash value life insurance. Insurance is the only thing where you can get a check that says a dividend, and it's because they charge you more than they were legally allowed. You know, the legal name for that rebate check that you get is called a dividend. To me, that's nasty. It's nasty. I'm sorry. Just my take. Strength and independence is the Marlboro brand. It's not cowboys. They're promoting a sense of instilling strength and independence. If it was cowboys, they couldn't have Marlboro on one of those Baja whatever racing vehicles. You know what I'm saying? Benefits, user imagery, you know, boldness, independence. You know, on the outside, those are some of the red roof graphic, red and white packaging, the Marlboro man, Marlboro Country, you know, endorsements of different sports. But you get how it's not, the cowboy is not their brand. The brand is the sense of strength and independence. I'm going to go over, Harv. I'll be done in five.
Okay. Thank you.
Take your time.
Can I have you call Shear?
Give me the phone.
Yeah, it's the top one, just a green. Thank you, Harv.
So this is straight cancel, right?
Just a green, yeah, Shear Jiang. Thank you. C-Rats, this is a friend of mine. He created a game. It's at thatpirategame.com. It's a free download board game. When you play it, you know what? You pretend like you're a pirate. So it gives you the experience, it's a pirate delivery mechanism, if you will. So what's the brand essence? You get to live pirate lore. That's our, you know, that's what it's delivering. So I'm going to come over here for a second. Part of the notion then is, what are the different emotions that build up to pirate lore? Well, it's like becoming mates. You get to feel like you're part of the crew. It's having adventure. It's carousing. It's conquering. It's masquerading. It's pillaging. It's role-playing. It's having a swagger. On the outside, on the other circle, are different places where you might come, wind up, you know, touching different elements. In the game, there's treasure. He sends emails to people that get it. There's historic parts involved in the game. There's the playing board. There's the board pieces. There's the gameplay. The people that play with the instructions. In each of these points of contact with the customer, you want to reinforce the notion of pirate lore, making it as authentic as possible and as inspiring to get the people to go along and play. Hula hoop. Who here can hula hoop? We are. Oh, yeah. Let's give a round of applause for Brian. All good. Come on up.
It's been about 20 years, so let's see.
Woo! Cool. Well, I don't know if you can hear it. One of the guys inside of the hula hoop. Here, let me have it for a second. Is Roxanne Rosen? Roseanne. There's also the little sand thing that's in here. Yep. Thank you, Roseanne. It's the little things that make the difference. The sand thing going, that encourages you to keep going. You know, it's part of the visceral sound. It's engaging the user at another level. There's a person in Atlanta that does dog sitting. It's a company called Paws. Really cute graphics and all sorts of stuff along those lines. And on Mother's Day, they send out little bags of dog food with a cute little card. They killed it. It was awful. They put the generic dog food in the thing. And I heard people say, is that what they feed my dog? It's the little things. It's the little things. So here was, this was my legend platform for last year. inside debunking consensus reality. I had in there strong Bucky flavor because I talked a lot about Buckminster Fuller, and then I put like Mind Fox and orgasms. But I found that that was limiting in terms of the audiences that I could play. Some people didn't want that level of intensity. So to try and reach a more mass audience, instead, this is what I've got this year. The notion's magic. It's a little bit easier to understand than debunking consensus reality. Instead of the orgasms and, I won't say, we've got breakthroughs. So we've got order forms that are coming out, and so here's what I want to offer to you guys. I'm going to be offering to you guys a 3-day magic class. And the magic class is also a creativity, innovation, back-end product development class. For the last 2 years, I've been working with Harry Martinus and Gary Seldon, Kennesaw State University, and teaching creativity to MBA students and going into companies. In less than 2 hours, we can teach people how to quadruple the quantity of ideas that they can sit down and generate at will. We're going to be teaching that technology and working with you in terms of developing your back-end product development, whatever you want your back-end product to be. I'm also going to be teaching magic because I believe that teaching how magic works helps people understand how other people process reality and process mediums and create their perceptions. So it's 3 days. It's going to be July 20th, 21st, and 22nd. This is going to be $29.95 for the $5.97 on there. What I've got is an ebook that I'm going to give out to people that buy. There's also going to be a 6-week teleseminar course where I'm going to be going through a quarter of this in each of the teleseminars. It's going to be 1 hour of teleseminar of me talking, and then later in the week there's going to be another part where I answer questions that people have. I'll be looking at questions live as it goes and getting questions, but it's trying to make it as interactive as possible. My real goal is to try and get case studies from you guys. And I wrote down here the $5.97, and the reason is, you know that green thing that I've got for you guys here? If you simply write down anything on here that you're going to use, it's $1,000 off these prices. So as opposed to it being $29.95, it's going to be $1,995. As opposed to it being $15.97, it's going to be $597. Just give me one thing from this that you know, from the lecture today, that you know that you can use immediately. That's going to help me uncover what my unique selling proposition is. Make sense? Harv also said, he goes, Ben, people paid a lot of money to get in here. I want you to give them the best possible deal that you can. And I was like, Harv, you're twisting my arm. And he goes, yes. And so I said, okay. So it's another $100 off. It's $497 for this, $1,895 for the 3-day. Anyways, I've got to get out to UCLA. I hope you guys are all engaged. And thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, let's hear it, guys. Come on. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Hold on, man. Thank you.
Hey, Joe.
How are you?
One second. Come back for 1 second. I have a little something for you. I'll get a basket. Enjoy yourself.
Hey, give her a round of applause. Thank you so much.